My greatest fear is probably dying with no one knowing of any contribution I'd ever made to creative music. But that's cool because I made an album already that I'm so proud of that, you know, if I died tomorrow, touch wood, you know, I would still feel fulfilled in a way.
Completely. You give your
Mlada Amy Winehouse, lijepa djevojka predivnog glasa za čiju se tada karijeru brinuo management benda Spice Girls i Davida Beckhama, prezirala je drogu, sve dok nije upoznala ljubav svog života Blakea Civila, muškarca za kojeg mnogi tvrde da ju je uništio.
What do you think why she started to smoke cannabis and drinking alcohol?
Because the when she was taking drugs, she dealt with the addiction side of the drugs. She dealt with that, but she didn't deal with the underlying reason. It's when we say, it's, you know, she had complex needs. So one addiction will lead to another. You know, the next addiction was exercise. She was exercising for 4 hours, 5 hours a day. Very healthy, very fit. Then she would go and buy clothes all day long. And I'd take them back the next day, and then the next thing was alcohol. So she never dealt with the underlying reasons that she had to. She dealt with the fact that she physically didn't have to take drugs anymore, but emotionally she still needed to drink. She liked to drink. She liked the taste of it, and that's dangerous.
What was your first impression of Blake?
My first impression of Blake was he was okay. I didn't know he was a drug addict. I didn't know anything about him, and he seemed to be a very, very charming, friendly guy. That was my first impression.
And then?
Well, then things changed. As you know, it's in the papers. He said that he introduced Amy to Class A drugs, and he used Amy. He manipulated Amy, and it's a fact. And Amy for Blake was fantastic because she had lots of money.
Do you think that he played a role in Amy's death?
No, not at all.
You stated also in the book that one of the biggest selling UK albums of the 21st century was about low life scumbag that God ever put breath into.
He didn't really have control over his actions. His brain, because when you're taking drugs, your brain chemistry changes. He couldn't help being the way that he was. It's like an inbuilt thing that you have to maximize all the opportunities you have to get money, to buy drugs, and to steal from people. He couldn't help it.
But how do you explain her obsession with Blake? It was like an addiction.
Think about the worst boyfriend that you've had. And your mum and dad said to you, why do you see this boy? Did they have that conversation with you?
Of course.
Okay, so now that's the answer to your question, isn't it? And the more they said to you, I don't want you to see that boy, the more you want to see him. You know, at the time, it didn't look like it was going to be a problem. He looked like a, you know, I knew straight away he wasn't working, he was lazy, and he was living off of, I mean, just the fact that he was allowing Amy to pay for everything for him, that was bad enough. When we found out that there was drugs involved as well, and he was, you know, he was getting drugs, and then it went crazy. But, you know, Amy, like every young lady, chooses the person that they want to be with, and the parents can, like, you can stand on your head, it doesn't make any difference.
He walks away. Do you think that Blake really loved Amy?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
I do. And she really loved him. Love can be made up of all different kinds of things. It can be security, it could be sexual, it could be emotional. And with those two, it was all of those things, plus codependency on drugs. And Blake had a history previously, of manipulating women and getting them to self-harm. and things like that, and he got Amy to self-harm.
How because, do you explain
well,
that?
Well, he would say to her, when she was going into withdrawal, he said, if you cut yourself, your focus goes onto the cut and you forget about your withdrawal. It's bullshit. It's just another form of coercion. He's saying, I want you to cut yourself. If you cut yourself, it proves that you love me. That's what it's all about.
I think I've come to the realisation that life is short as well, you know? Got to live in the moment.
Did he ever increase maybe her insecurities? Or
what I think he did increase her insecurities. You know, that's a part of the control. That's the manipulation. He's saying to her, everyone else thinks you're ugly. I think you're beautiful.
She was actually never completely satisfied with what she did. Is that true? Was she a bit insecure as a person?
I think she was insecure as a person, but I don't think her dissatisfaction came from insecurity. I think she was a perfectionist in everything.
In every aspect of life.
In every aspect. And I'm only now beginning to appreciate that. She would never listen to her old music, never. In fact, I was with her in Canada when one of her songs came over, we heard it in a supermarket, and she said, isn't that me, Dad? I said, yeah, that's you. She said, well, I remember. And she said, I remember that song. You know, she wrote the song, but she said, oh, I remember it.
Osim Blake-a, svi su se željeli okoristiti Amy-nim novcem. Prijatelji su krijumčarili drogu u bolnicu, a Blake-ovi roditelji su tabloidima svakodnevno prodavali priče o njoj.
You were in constant conflict with Blake's parents. Actually, they were selling stories about Amy to tabloids. They still do that. How did that influence her? I mean, when she read
influence
that...
Influence her?
Yeah.
She hated his parents. They got on okay at the beginning, but she then realised what they were. His mother wasn't a drug addict. She sold stories, she sold Amy's personal letters to Blake, and that is illegal. We sued her, we won our case, and now she's doing it again. It's a very difficult situation. The best thing to do is just to ignore her because she's just a nobody.
They tried to make me go to rehab, I said no.
When Amy was a drug addict, she never wanted to go to rehab. After, when she stopped with drugs, when she was alcoholic, she was, you know, check herself into the detox or something, but she wanted to help herself.
You know, it's a strange thing to say. She was always worried about her health, which is strange, you know, someone who's a drug addict. And she, you know, when she had a boob job, if she had a pain in her boobs, straight to the hospital. She had a pain in her stomach, straight to the hospital. She was worried about her health. And I'd say to her, if you're so worried about your health, why are you taking drugs or why are you drinking like this? Every 5 minutes she was going to the hospital. She liked the hospital and she felt safe there. And the nurses loved her. So she'd go into the hospital and the place was full of Arabs. And you know, with all the women and the men and that with all the heads things. And she'd make me go to Agent Provocateur, you know, the underwear. And I'd have to buy her all this sexy stuff. And she'd be in the hospital walking around in all the, it was very funny, very, very funny. I mean, she was hilarious.
When she was, you know, like under the alcohol or drugs, occasionally, she would, you know, do some things like a bit embarrassing on the stage when she was performing or something. How would she feel the next day?
She'd feel bad. After Belgrade, which I could never see, she said that she screwed everything up. I think she spoke to Reg and she said, that's the end of the tour.
All I can ever be to you is the darkness that we know and this regret I got accustomed to.
Now when you remember Amy, what's the first thing that comes on your mind?
Laughing. Just laughing all the time.
When you looked at her last time, how did she look?
Beautiful. That was the image that I had in my mind all the time, and I've managed to put that over there. And now here is, you know, her lovely face laughing, which is what even during the bad times, there was still lots of laughter. That's what got us through it.